The pandemic is primarily a story of lives lost or terribly damaged, but it's also a story of countries' economies steamrolled. The extent of damage to one of the world's major economies was laid bare today. Rishi Sunak, the British Chancellor of the Exchequer, or Senior Finance Minister, told Parliament that the UK faced the largest fall in output for 300 years. The figures across borrowing, debt and unemployment are astonishing. Let's try and put them all in some context. Judy Stephenson is an economic historian at University College London.
So he was referring to the big drop in 1709. There was a drop about 15% in 1706 and again in 1709. And that was really brought about by the weather. Temperatures dropped to Arctic temperatures and crops froze in the ground. Rivers froze, roads were impassable, and people starved. And as a result, trade and output and all sorts of services stopped as well. And so GDP output dropped by 15 to 20%.
Right. Just putting it in the context of it being the worst drop in 300 years, I suppose, gives us some sense of perspective. In terms, then, I realise you're an economic historian rather than a soothsayer, but in terms of looking ahead, yeah. If you have that severity of shock to an economy, how deep can the scarring be?
What happens afterwards depends on what happens to prices and supply and demand. If we manage to stabilise the economy now and keep as many people as possible employed and find alternative employment for those displaced, then that is reasonable. However, if you get a really big inflation or another shock or set of lockdowns which begin to displace people even more, then the effects become longer run.
Correct me if I'm wrong. What I'm hearing you say is that we shouldn't necessarily be overawed and terrified by the levels of debt and borrowing, but it's things like long-term unemployment which can really cause social disruption.
Absolutely. What matters going forward is not the debt. Everything historically says that it's manageable and it's probably sustainable, but it's only sustainable if you keep people in employment. The real shocks and the real effects, damaging effects, are if people become out of work and if they lose their skills. And then also if we have a generation who have missed out on education and skills and work experience and never can really get a foothold in labour markets and productivity. That's what we should be concentrating on, and that's what we should be worrying about. And that's why the policy that looks to keep people in employment is pretty much the right thing to do.
You also mentioned we need to take into account whether there are further shocks, and there are some people who are saying that Brexit and indeed the possibility of a no-deal Brexit, Britain having left its sort of transitional period with the European Union and not having a free trade agreement with the EU sorted out by the end of this year, that could provide another severe economic disruption. Is that the sort of thing that you're talking about?
Yes. Brexit is likely to hit services, high-end services, which are no longer sort of passportable, which are very productive and quite important to the UK economy, and manufacturing, which isn't a large part of the UK economy, but is important structurally to everywhere outside of London. And that won't happen immediately, but with no deal, it will happen slowly. And unless we are able to replace the employment and the value added in those sectors in the next couple of years, then there will be long-term effects. So it's the conflation of Brexit and the demand slump of COVID could have quite severe consequences.
The economic historian, Judy Stephenson. You're listening to NewsHour.